Well, here I say, well, what it will be my talk about first. Sorry, I will look if this works. Yes. Okay. I will talk what are polyphenols, polyphenols and health outcomes. It's working, no? Yes, yes. Okay, thank you very much. Well, which polyphenols we have in beer, and finally, why these polyphenols from beer can have a health effect? Well, talking about polyphenols, well, polyphenols are a curious compounds because initially they were compounds that were giving problems in food, no? Because they participate in color, and as they are antioxidant, when they are oxidate, they can give brown colors that can give problems to food technology. So initially they were considered like as problematic, not as interesting for their health effect. So if we look what we had published in, well, what it was published, sorry, in PubMed in 1991, we have only in 12 months, only 23 papers published talking about polyphenols, because initially they didn't have any interest for health. However, if we look at now, we have 1,318 papers in 12 months. The things have changed a lot. After one paper that was published in 1992 about the French paradox, there was a lot of papers that have been published talking about polyphenols and health. So if we look now, what we know about polyphenols nowadays, they are not considered nutrients because they are not considered essential. They are not considered that if we don't use if we don't have them, we will have health problems. However, they are very, very important as bioactive compounds since they perform very important physiological functions in the organism. The problem that we have with polyphenols that we can see here, I will not talk about that because this is very complex chemistry, but is that we have a lot of compounds inside polyphenols. This is one of the problems that the people who is working with polyphenols or doing research in polyphenols is having, no? That there are so many structures, so many compounds, that sometimes it's difficult to know which is the exact polyphenol that has the physiological action. Well, and what about polyphenols and health outcomes? I will focus on what we have done, but there are many, many papers published about polyphenols and health. Well, you have measured that polyphenols consumption, looking what was the effect of polyphenols in cardiovascular health. For that, we used the PREDIMED study that has been led by Dr. Struck. That it was initially the study was done to evaluate the Mediterranean diet in cardiovascular prevention. However, here we also take the data to evaluate the polyphenols consumption and the effect of polyphenols. So in this study, we had 7,447 people that were at high risk of having cardiovascular problems, but they are free of cardiovascular. They still have not had any cardiovascular event. And what were we doing? We were measuring through the Phenol Explorer database the polyphenols consumption during 5 years. So we were looking the polyphenols consumption, the accumulative polyphenols consumption during the 5 years of the PREDIMED. Well, we published this. The paper was called Inverse Association Between Polyphenols and Cardiovascular Events. And let's look, well, here we cannot see it very well, but here we have what this population consumes of polyphenols. Here is the people who is consuming less polyphenols, and here is the people who are having more polyphenols in their diet. And what we can observe, if we observe the last column, that is if we eliminate all the possible confounder factors, if this number is, like Professor De Witte before has told, if it's below one, this is interesting because it means that there is a reduction in cardiovascular events. But the important thing is that these two numbers are also below one. And what we observe here is that it's 0.54, that this could be 46% of protection. And then this will be total polyphenols consumption. So total polyphenols are protecting us from having cardiovascular events. However, if we look which compounds are having more effect, lignans, for example, here, if we look the people who are consuming more lignans, they are more, they are more protected, almost 50%. Here we have also anthocyanins. Anthocyanins are typical from berries. They are not significant. They are not totally significant because here we see the number. It's a little higher from one. However, there is a tend to decrease, and it happens the same with this. However, we will continue with the ones that are giving significantly. Flavanols, these are present in beer, and we see that they are having very, very significant effect also in cardiovascular events. And this, for me, these are very important. These compounds are really high in beer, and in some populations, these compounds come mainly from beer consumption. And what we observe, hydroxybenzoics, they have also very high protection in predimat populations. However, we wanted to go more, and we wanted to evaluate the mortality, all case of mortality also in the predimat. So here, initially, we look if the people who were consuming more polyphenols were having less, were having a decrease in mortality risk. And here we have the people who are consuming low, here the people who are consuming medium, and here the people who are consuming more. And what we observe is there is a decrease in mortality with the people who are having more polyphenols. Moreover, if we see which flavonols are having effects, we see isoflavones that are also present in beer. We have stilbenes, that the famous one is resveratrol, and lignans. All their compounds, total polyphenols also, the consumption of total polyphenols. Moreover, all these compounds are protecting us from mortality. But let's look what we have in beer. What are the specific phenolics we have in beer? Well, we look at the phenolic composition from beer, and what we observe that before also Professor DeWitt has mentioned, analyzing three common beers, we observe that there were almost 50 phenols that we could identify in beer, well, 47 phenols. With seven of them were totally new. They have never been described. And here we have the phenolics that are mainly on beer. These are coming mainly from malt, and we have, again, the hydroxybenzoic acids that I have mentioned before that they were very important for protecting cardiovascular effects. And here in red, we have the ones that we have identified for the first time. But as we can observe, in beer we have many, many different kinds of phenolic compounds. And here again, the flavonols that before we have also observed that they were protecting us from cardiovascular disease. We have also discovered some new flavonols in beer, some new flavones in beer. But it's what I was mentioned before. The polyphenolic compound is really a very complex wall, no? Because there are many, many structures, many, many compounds that is sometimes difficult to understand all these structures. Well, and then we have some polyphenols that are really, really characteristic from beer. Why? Because they came from hop, and hop is usually not used in any other food, no? Unless you have some hop pills, that is not usual, you are not having these polyphenols. We have around 20-30% of these the polyphenols from beer that are coming from hops, mainly prenyl flavonoids. If we look how many polyphenols we consume when we have one beer, we can see that we have approximately 92 polyphenols. Well, let's compare of a regular drinks that are usually famous for their polyphenols content, no? If we look at white wine, for one drink it has 48 polyphenols for one drink, for one unit regular drink. And if we look at red wine, it will have 300 milligrams. So beer will be in the middle of white wine and red wine. And if we look how they can protect this, this is not from our research, from our group, this is from other groups, we observe that it's we look what the, how they can protect cardiovascular disease. Wine is approximately, it reduced 32%, and beer around 22%. So beer has a strong protection against cardiovascular disease. Well, let's look at these specific polyphenols that beer has. Well, in beer, we have these polyphenols that came from hops that are prenyl flavonoids. Initially, we have in hop, we have it as xanthohumol. However, during the brewing process, as we were looking yesterday in the factory, you know, there is an isomerization due to the yeast, and this xanthohumol is converted to isoxanthohumol, that is in another phenolic compound. However, this compound, when you take a beer, when you take beer, it's this converted to another phenolic compound that its name is 8-phenylnaringenine. It's a new compound, very interesting new compound, because if we look the properties of these compounds, 8-phenylnaringenine is considered a very potent phytoestrogen. It can be, it's very important for health reasons, especially for women to avoid problems in the, when the problems that well, that can be avoided due to estrogenic, due to the lack of estrogens. So this is very important, especially in health, for health for women. But moreover, we have also xanthohumol. Xanthohumol is in low amount in beer, and isoxanthohumol. They have weak estrogenic active. However, isoxanthohumol is considered a very good source in the body of the 8-phenylnaringenine, because it's converted, as we have seen, to this compound. However, we wanted to see, to evaluate the effect of beer, to wanted to see which of this compound could be a good biomarker of beer consumption. So what we did is we did a dose-response randomized crossover clinical trial with 20 male and 20 women, using different doses of beer. There was one drink, two drinks, and three drinks. And this was for women, is more sensitive to alcohol, we were giving less, no? And after 8 hours, we were taking the urine. And look at what we observe in the results. After 8 hours, we see that there is a clear dose response, so more dose, there is more excretion of isoxanthohumol in urine in men and in women. In women, there is more variability, but this we have observed with other phenolic compounds. Women are more special, we could say. No? They have, there is also more variation among the behavior of women with polyphenols. But we can see here that it's really very good biomarker of beer consumption. However, what is interesting of a biomarker is that you look to a living free population, it can differentiate if people drink beer or it doesn't drink beers. We did that in the PREDIMED, and we look at people without not knowing if they were having beer or they were not having beer, and we observed that it's really a very specific biomarker, no? Because people who were not getting any drink, we didn't get any isoxanthohumol in urine. However, the people who were having beer, they were giving this compound, this compound in beer. And what is that interesting, no? Because it's a good biomarker that can be used in epidemiological studies to evaluate beer health outcome, because you are really sure that the people who you want to know if they are having, if the beer is having an effect on health, do you have to have a good biomarker? And this compound can be really a very good biomarker. So to finish, what I would like to conclude, no, that polyphenols really, the consumption of polyphenol really decreased all causes of mortality and cardiovascular disease. Beer has been shown to be a good source of polyphenol and is one of the main food contributors to hydroxybenzoic acid intake in the EPIC study. High intake of hydroxybenzoic decreased cardiovascular risk by 30% in the PREDIMED study, so these compounds can reduce cardiovascular disease. And isoxanthohumol is really a good biomarker that may be used in epidemiological studies to evaluate beer health outcomes. Finally, I would like to thank all the people, well, all the societies or that has given me money, Cerveza en Salud, ERAP, CIBER, Fundación Clinic, that is participating in all our studies with Dr. Strub. Well, and also my research group, because we are participating in many studies to evaluate polyphenols and carotenoids in health, and this work couldn't be possible with all the people who is in this group. And finally, to all of you for listening.